5 years before the Prophet was given Nubuwwat, when basically when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was 35 years old, this was the third time the Kaaba was rebuilt. Now what happened is, obviously at that time the height of the Kaaba obviously was much shorter than we have it today, and like we have a roof on the Kaaba today, at that time there was no roof. So whenever it would rain, the Kaaba would get flooded, and obviously the walls of the Kaaba would get damaged, and cracks began appearing in the walls of the Kaaba. So all the Quraysh, they got together and they thought, right, what we're going to do is we're going to reconstruct this Kaaba again. While this was going on, Abu Wahab Amr al-Makhzumi, he was the maternal uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's father, Abdullah. So he stood up and he made an i'lan, he made an announcement that whoever is going to donate to this cause, to the construction of the Kaaba, please make it from amongst your purest of wealth. So that wealth that you have earned while selling alcohol, or that wealth that you have earned through prostitution, because at that time prostitution, it was very widespread. So people would earn a lot of money through prostitution, through haram, through robbing, through stealing. So he made this announcement that whoever is going to donate, please donate from your purest of wealth. After making this elan, what the Quraysh done was they got together and they shared out amongst them the construction of the Kaaba, so that no one is deprived of this privilege of constructing the Kaaba. And what they done was each tribe or each family, they had given a certain hissa, a certain part of the Kaaba, that it was their responsibility to get the material and to get the money together to build this part of the Kaaba. So I just want to mention a few of the families, what parts of the Kaaba they had. We've got Bani Zuhra and Bani Abd Manaf. They had the side where today, you know, where we see the door of the Kaaba, that side of the Kaaba that was built by Bani Zuhra and Bani Abd Manaf. Then we've got Bani Makhzum. They had some other families. Bani Makhzum had the side where Hajr Aswad is and Rukni Yamani. This side of the Kaaba, it was given to them, and it was their responsibility to sort out all the materials, to bring the materials and all the money that they needed for this side. Then we've got Bani Jamh. They had the roof. And we've got Bani Abdul Dar, Ibn Asad, and Bani Adi. They had the side where the Hatim is. You know, we've got the whole Kaaba. And then after that, we see that there is a sort of a semicircle. Now that semicircle, that is a part of the Kaaba. And the reason why that has been made like this is because of the announcement that the maternal uncle of Abdullah had made, that when you donate, please donate from your purest of wealth. Now because they didn't have enough pure wealth, they couldn't get enough material to build. So what they done is they just made that small semicircle just to indicate that this is a part of the Kaaba. That's why today the ulama, they say that when you go and you read your salah in that place, that is like reading it inside the Kaaba. So that part, that is also, so this was given to Bani Adi ibn Asad and Bani Abdul Dar. While this was all going on, some news came to the Quraysh that in a port in Jeddah, a ship has crashed and is broken down to pieces. It's broken down to pieces. One of the guys that were there, Walid ibn Mughira, he doesn't waste any time. He gets there straight away. He goes there and all those planks of wood that were useful, that were not damaged, he brought all those back to the Kaaba, and those were used as a roof for the Kaaba. And whilst he was there in the ship, there was a sailor that was from Rome. So he brought that sailor back with him so that he could help with the construction of the Kaaba. Now the time comes to actually break down the previous Kaaba. The original Kaaba that was there, it comes to break that down. So everybody's courage just shatters. Nobody wants to go forward to break down the Kaaba. Why? It's a sacred place. Calamity may befall us. Anything can happen. So everybody's sort of scared. So this same guy who had gone to collect this wood from Jeddah, he steps forward and he goes near the Kaaba, and he's got a really big hammer in his hand. And he goes and he does dua and he says, Allahumma la nuridu illa al-khair. That, O Allah, we do not intend anything but good. We don't intend to break this Kaaba down, you know, to disrespect it or to harm anyone. We only want to do it just so that we can reconstruct this Kaaba. So when he does this, he starts breaking down the Kaaba, and he begins from the end where the Hajar al-Aswad is. When he begins breaking this, all of the rest of the Quraysh, they push back. And they say that we're going to see tonight, if any calamity befalls Walid ibn Mughira, then we're not going to go forward, we're not going to go with it. And the bit that he's broken down, we'll rebuild that, and that'll be an indication from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this action that he's going to do, I'm not pleased with it. In the morning, when Walid wakes up, he comes out of his house and is heading towards the Kaaba to finish off the thing. He has sounded the pound. Everybody sees this and they go along with it. They break down the Kaaba. Now when they break down the Kaaba, the aforementioned distribution to all the tribes, everybody goes according to that and they build their own part of the Kaaba. The final piece is left, which is the Hajar al-Aswad, to put this in its place. Now, when it comes down to this point, these people, we can see, we know through history that these guys, they were crazy. So they began fighting, they began arguing, they began quarreling to such an extent that they began drawing their swords. Now when this stay lasted for a few days, one of the guys, the eldest person of Quraysh, whose name was Umayyah bin Mughira al-Makhzumi, he says, he comes up and he gives them an opinion. He says to them that, look, what we'll do is we'll wait till tomorrow morning and we'll see who the first person is to enter the haram of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whatever he says, we'll make him the judge, and his words are the final words. So everybody's happy with this. Everybody says, TK, no problem. In the morning when everybody's waiting, they see that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself, he walks into the haram. And all of a sudden, when all the whole of Quraysh, they see him, they say, Hada Muhammadun al-Amin. That this is Muhammad, the most trustworthy. Radina hada Muhammadun al-Amin. That we are happy this is Muhammad, the most trustworthy. Allahu Akbar, we've discussed the amanat dari, the trustworthiness and the reliability of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I don't want to go into it. So they begin saying this. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he comes forward, they explain everything to him, and he gives them an idea. What he says is, he calls for a cloth. A cloth is brought, and this Hajar al-Aswad is put right in the middle of this cloth. And then he says to the leaders of every tribe that each one of you take one corner. Each one of these leaders of the tribes, they pick up, they take one corner and they pick the Hajar al-Aswad up to its place where it's going to be placed. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself, he comes forward and with his own blessed hand, he takes it off the cloth and he places it in. Everybody is happy and he saved a huge war that could have taken place. This was the third time. The fourth time was in the Khilafat of Abdullah ibn Zubair. He had rebuilt the Kaaba, reconstructed the Kaaba once again, which was the fourth time. And the fifth time, this was in the time of Hajjaj ibn Yusuf. Hajjaj ibn Yusuf from amongst the Awwaleen and Akhirin, the first people and the last people, they say that Hajjaj ibn Yusuf was the biggest oppressor that has ever set foot on earth. This guy had killed thousands of Sahaba. He had slaughtered thousands of Sahaba, but still Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the ability again to rebuild and reconstruct the Kaaba of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I just want to finish there. I just want to draw your attention to something that we've got a channel on the YouTube, Al-Islam Productions. Now, what it is whenever we've realized there's a bit of a problem that whenever somebody types in Al-Islam Productions, it goes straight to another channel which is called Al-Islam Organization. And both are regarding the seerat of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We've got Al-Islam Productions and we've got Al-Islam Organization. Al-Islam Productions, as you know, we are Muslim, alhamdulillah, bifadlillah. And Al-Islam Organization, they also talk about the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But I just thought I'd make you aware of it, that these people, they're Qadiani, bil ittifaq, they are not Muslim, they're kafir, they're kharij anil Islam. They're out of the fold of Islam. So I just thought that quite a few people, they've made the mistake on going and listening to these people, thinking that it's our Islam Productions. So please, if you do type it in, and if you go to it, then please make sure that you're going on to the right ones. Ours is Islam Productions, and theirs is Al-Islam Organization. I just want to finish there. Wa akhiru da'wana, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.